Dear Lord, thank you again for this day and for this hour. And even our Lord, as we have studied this lesson about your prophet Jeremiah, God, we ask that you would give us the spirit, power, love, and a sound mind to speak truth to power. We know, oh God, that as you lead us through our words, you said in your word that you would never leave us nor forsake us. So God, give us the power to speak your word with holy boldness. In the name that's above every name, in the name of your son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture comes from Jeremiah chapter 38, verses 14 through 23, Common English Bible. King Zedekiah ordered that the prophet Jeremiah be brought to him at the third entrance of the Lord's temple, where the king said to Jeremiah, "I want to ask you something, and don't hide anything from me." Jeremiah replied, "If I do, you'll kill me. And if I tell you what to do, you won't listen to me." So King Zedekiah swore to Jeremiah behind closed doors, "As the Lord lives, who has given us this life, I won't put you to death, and I won't hand you over to those who seek to kill you." So Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "The Lord of heavenly forces, the God of Israel, proclaims, if you surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, you and your family will live, and this city will not be burned down. If you don't surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, the city will be handed over to the Babylonians, who will burn it down, and you won't escape from them." King Zedekiah said to Jeremiah, "I'm afraid that I will fall into the hands of the Judeans who have defected to the Babylonians, and they will torture me." "That won't happen," Jeremiah replied. "If you obey the Lord, whose message I bring, you will survive and all will go well for you. But if you refuse to surrender, this is what the Lord has shown me. All the women left in the palace of the king of Judah will be led out to the officers of the king of Babylon, and they will say, 'Your trusted friends have betrayed you. They have deceived you. Now that your feet are stuck in the mud, they are nowhere to be found. All your wives and children will be led out to the Babylonians, and you yourself won't escape from them. The king of Babylon will capture you, and this city will be burned down.'"
Greetings, May 16th. Welcome to Church School, The Consequences of Giving Challenging Advice, as we continue to talk about the prophets. And today we talk from the prophet of Jeremiah, the 38th chapter, verses 14 through 22. No one wants to be the bearer of bad news or challenging advice. How can we find courage to speak when what we have to say is likely to cause controversy or hard feelings? Jeremiah frankly discussed his concerns with King Zedekiah and then spoke with confidence that he was delivering a message from God. The goals for today is to identify Jeremiah's hesitation to give controversial advice to Zedekiah, to sense Jeremiah's apprehension when talking to Zedekiah, and then to commit to giving challenging, godly advice. Verses 14 through 16, there's agreement between King Zedekiah and prophet Jeremiah. Then Zedekiah the king sent and had Jeremiah the prophet brought to him in the third entrance of the house of the Lord. And the king said to Jeremiah, "I will ask you something. Hide nothing from me." Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "If I declare it to you, you will surely put me to death. And if I give you advice, you will not listen to me." So Zedekiah the king swore secretly to Jeremiah, saying, "As the Lord lives, who made our very souls, I will not put you to death, nor will I give you into the hand of these men who seek your life." As in Jeremiah 37:16, King Zedekiah wanted a private meeting with Jeremiah. There are several similarities between the events of Jeremiah 37 and Jeremiah 38. And some commentators believe the two chapters describe the same event from different perspectives. Nevertheless, the two chapters, chapters 37 and 38, are more different than alike. Let me give you examples. Different charges are made against Jeremiah. Different places of incarceration are made, is shown. Different matters of rescue are exhibited. Different places of meeting with the king are shown. Different conversations with the king take place. Given this, it is more likely that they are indeed separate, though similar, events. Jeremiah was true to his character, and Zedekiah was true to his character. So the same drama might have been acted out in similar, yet different ways. If I declare to you, will you not surely put me to death? Zedekiah begged Jeremiah to tell him the truth, but Jeremiah feared the king could not handle the truth. Jeremiah feared that at best he would be ignored. You will not listen to me. At worst, he would be put to death. Zedekiah was swore to Jeremiah in the name of the Lord that he would not kill the prophet nor allow others to do so. Strangely, a king who did not live as the Lord lived swore an oath as the Lord lives. But what credit was it was to be given to his oath, who was notoriously known to be a perjured person as having broken his oath of fidelity to Nebuchadnezzar? He also knows that what poor security a solemn oath is. From this man amounts to an inverse ratio, as often happens, to the strength of his language. And then in verses 17, 18, of the final word of Zedekiah, a final offer of mercy. Then Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "Thus says the Lord, the God of hosts, the God of Israel, if you surely surrender in the king of Babylon's princes, then your soul shall live. This city shall not be burned with fire, and you and your house shall live. But if you do not surrender to the king of Babylon's princes, then this city shall be given into the hand of the Chaldeans. They shall burn it with fire, and you shall not escape from their hand. Thus says the Lord of God of hosts, the God of Israel." Jeremiah agreed to take the risk and deliver God's message to King Zedekiah. In speaking through Jeremiah, God began the word by identifying God's self. Yahweh, the covenant God of Israel, the God of hosts, the God of heavenly armies and all their power, the God of Israel, the master and Lord of the covenant, descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This was not a new word to Zedekiah. Perhaps it had a new urgency, but it was not a new word. The Babylonians were God's instrument of judgment against Judah, and therefore resistance against them was foolish and futile. It was therefore was better to surrender to them and to surrender to God's will. All was indeed lost, as God announced in Jeremiah 38:3, and Jerusalem's suicidal stand had not even a tactical value now that the whole country was overrun and the Egyptian thrust had failed. Only obstinacy, at whatever cost it lives, could prolong the agony. And it was obstinacy not only against the enemy, but against the Lord. This was God's remarkable patience and mercy to a king who rejected God's word many, many times before. Zedekiah could not prevent the conquest of Jerusalem by his repentance, but he could make that conquest much less severe. Even now at its late hour, if he surrendered, his soul shall live. He would survive and not be put to death. If he surrendered, the city shall not be burned with fire. Jerusalem would be spared total destruction. If he surrendered, your house shall live. His wives, children, and royal family would be largely spared from death. All he had to do was trust the prophet to lift his head high, to take up the flag of truce, walk past the princes and out to the Chaldean armies. The simple act of contrition would have saved the city. Surrender to the king of Babylon's princes. Zedekiah knew what it was to surrender to princes. He shamefully surrendered to the princes of Judah in Jeremiah 38:4. Through Jeremiah, God warned Zedekiah to surrender to the right princes. The city shall not be burned with fire. The fate of the city rested with one man's repentance and trust in the Lord. Surrender to the Babylonians would spare the city of Jerusalem. They would be conquered but not destroyed and burned with fire. It was an astounding invitation, all the more so for the previous withholding of all hope for Jerusalem apart from its rebuilding. And then in verses 19 to 23, as we come to the end of this text, God's assurance to Zedekiah through Jeremiah. Listen to these words. And Zedekiah the king said to Jeremiah, I am afraid of the Jews who have defeated, have defected to the Chaldeans, lest they deliver me into their hand and they abuse me. But Jeremiah said, they shall not deliver you. Please, please obey the voice of the Lord which I speak to you, so it shall be with you and your soul shall live. But if you refuse to surrender, this is the word that the Lord has shown me. Now behold, all the women who are left in the king Judah's house shall be surrendered to the king of Babylon's princes, and those women shall say, your close friends have set upon me and prevailed against you. Your feet have sunk into the mire and they have turned away again. So they shall surrender all your wives and children to the Chaldeans. You shall not escape from their hand, but shall be taken by the hand of the king of Babylon. And you shall cause the city to be burned with fire. Like all of us, Zedekiah could always think of a reason why obedience to God wasn't such a good idea. He thought that those who had already defected to the Chaldeans might abuse him in some way. Once again, Zedekiah's weakness of character shows up. There was a course of action to be followed, which he knew to be right, but he lacked the courage to take it. It may be that the only abuse he had to fear was mocking and contempt from those who surrendered earlier. We surrendered months ago when you told us to continue to fight. Look who has surrendered now. Look how wrong you were. Jeremiah appealed to the king, knowing that always the safest thing to do is to obey the voice of the Lord. There would be a blessing for obedience and a curse for disobedience. Jeremiah warned the king, you're worried about what these defectors will say. Don't worry about that. Worry about what the wives of your harem will say when they are surrendered to the king of Babylon's princes. Your close friends have set upon you. Jeremiah spoke a short piece of poetry, voicing the devastation that the wives and the children of Zedekiah and Jerusalem would feel at the violence and destruction that would come if the king continued his disobedience to God. Women and children of the king's household would be led out to the Babylonian officials, claiming as they went what may have been brief traditional song about being betrayed by friends and being deserted as you work in the mud. In the utterance of the prophet, here's the female court members and the royal household singing a bitter taunt song, expressing the shame of their captivity and degradation by enemy military and diplomatic personnel. More cutting than the ridicule of defectors whom Zedekiah feared would be the ridicule the palace women would heap on him for his gullibility and trusting faithless allies. Nothing could change the fact that as God's instrument, the Babylonians would conquer Judah and Jerusalem. Yet the obedience or disobedience of the person could determine the extent of the misery and destruction in that conquest. It was a strong, courageous word Jeremiah brought to Zedekiah. The king had previously shown him mercy and promised him bread, but the bread the king put in his mouth, in the mouth of the prophet, did not prevent Jeremiah from speaking the truth to Zedekiah. Nothing is more marked throughout this story than the absolute, unswerving loyalty of Jeremiah to the message of judgment which he was called to deliver. The consequences of giving challenging advice. That's our lesson for today, May 16th. Commend the challenges to you on the next slide.